Okay. Ah, no, now it doesn't work any longer. Fine, okay. So, well, good afternoon, everybody, or good morning in your case, I don't know. We go now to lecture three, which is also about the stochastic gravitational wave background from the early universe. But in this lecture, I will try to discuss more the dynamics, let's say, so the source, how this gravitational wave signal can be sourced in the early universe. While in lecture two, we discussed more its general properties, like why it is stochastic, what can be its characteristic frequency, how it is related to the epoch at which the source is acting, and these kind of things. So let's go on then. We are still with the evolution equation for the gravitational waves that will accompany us for the entire set of lectures. So here, so in this lecture, I want to talk about the source. That makes me think that there was a question yesterday concerning how I define things in the review, and so I will, I have looked at this and I will say something maybe at the end of the lecture about this. Okay, so here, just to fix ideas for now, I would like to give some examples of what are possible sources of this tensor anisotropic stress in the early universe. So you might think, for example, so many things are done with the scalar fields in the very early universe, and in general, this as inflaton, for example, at the background level, the scalar field must be space independent to satisfy the condition of homogeneity and isotropy of the background universe. But at the level of perturbations, a scalar field can have gradients. So it can be space dependent and it can have space gradients. Now, if there is a scalar field configuration and in the early universe and it arranges itself such that its gradients have a tensor, a transverse and traceless component, then in general this can be a source of gravitational waves. So it would lead to tensor anisotropic stresses that are then can act as a source of gravitational waves. Another example of processes that can occur in the early universe is that if we have, for some reason, that the fluid of the universe, so the early universe plasma, is set into motion by some mechanism. We will see one example later, a concrete example. In that case, there is going to be some bulk velocity in the fluid. And this is the typical space part of the bulk velocity of the fluid. I am not writing the trace because neither here actually, the trace obviously goes to zero in this case. So, but if we have the presence of large scale bulk velocity, and again, the velocity configuration arranges itself so that the transverse traces part does not vanish. Typically, for example, if this velocity field is spherically symmetric, that its transverse traces part will be zero. But if it is not, then it could give rise to a tensor component in the anisotropic stresses and source gravitational waves. And another example is the presence of large-scale electromagnetic fields. So in this case, the electromagnetic energy momentum tensor always has a transverse traces component, which is this component here. So whenever in general there are large scale electromagnetic fields in the early universe, they will lead to the production of gravitational waves, of a gravitational wave background. The last concrete example I want to give is the case of second order scalar perturbations. So during inflation, one generates first order scalar metric perturbations from the quantum fluctuation of the inflaton field, but if the conditions are such that these perturbations become of order one, so they are no longer perturbations but they become sizable with respect to the background, then it might happen that at second order, so at the order in which I make the product of scalar perturbation, you know, the second order is of the same size of the first order, let's say. And in this case, again, if there are, so on top of that, there might be phase gradients of these of the perturbations, and then this can also, if they arrange in a transverse phase manner, produce a background of gravitational waves. And there are actually many other cases, and we will see some of them later on. But for now, what I wanted to do, after having just, you know, fixed ideas with these general examples, is to find a solution of the gravitational wave propagation equation, but keeping the gravitational wave source as general as possible. So I'm not specifying what these tensor anisotropy stresses are coming from. Where these tensor anisotropy stresses are coming from, but I'm just leaving it general, and try to find the spectrum of the gravitational waves. Of course, this is more of an academic exercise, but I find it an instructive one because you know, it describes what you should. What you in general do when you are dealing with a physical source. Okay, so the first consideration is that just as the background of gravitational waves that are generated, also the source must be treated as a stochastic variable. And this is simply, so we saw this in the last lecture, so the gravitational waves inherit the fact of being accessible only statistically from the characteristic of the source, which is causality. So here I'm, again, not dealing with the inflationary case, but you already know this since here there is a non-zero source, right? So so the characteristic of the source is such that it respects causality, and therefore it is correlated on scales that must be smaller than the Abel scale at the time at which the source is acting. Or if the source goes on for several Abel times, well, it must be always uncorrelated at sub-Abel scales. And in this case, at largest case, it can be described as a stochastic variable. So in the case of the source, I can, we have seen in the last lecture that the pi ij can also be decomposed in plus and cross polarizations, right? In a right by properly chosen basis. So here I write down then the two-point correlation function in K space of the source. This average is the same average that we were doing in the last two lectures. So ensemble average, which becomes a volume or time average, in this case volume average, under the ergodic hypothesis. And we have the delta function because of homogeneity and isotropy. we have this delta function, which says that I am not I'm considering a source which is parity preserving. And then here is the power spectrum, so the power spectrum of the anisotropic stress, and notice that I take it at an equal time. So here I'm correlating pi of k at time tau and pi of q at time zeta. And why I do that is will be clear in the following. Now, let us suppose that this gravitational wave source is operating over a given time interval in conformal time, okay? So from an initial time to a final time. And I forgot to mention here, I'm only concerned with the radiation dominated era. So I am solving for a generic stochastic source in the which is operating during the radiation era. Okay, so obviously the solution to this equation is trivial if you do it with the Green function or with the Wronskian method, and it is just the integral of the Green function times the source. So here now this guy is really the random variable itself. Okay, it is not yet the anisotropic stress because H here, the gravitational wave or tensor mode is also just a random variable. And I am solving, writing down the solution for times during which the source is still operating. Now we suppose that the source lasts for a finite time interval, and therefore to find what I'm interested in, which is the gravitational wave signal today, obviously I need to perform a matching, okay, because at some point the source stopped operating. And so at time, for every time which is larger than the final time, the gravitational wave is just freely propagating waves. So this is the typical solution. We had it already in the last lecture. We derived it in the last lecture. So what I need to do then is to match this particular solution and its derivative, both taken at time eta final, to this solution here in order to find the coefficients. So basically what I'm saying is that the solution is giving the initial conditions for the homogeneous solution. And by the way, obviously, the initial condition for this solution is that at initial time it is zero. Okay, so the matching procedure can be done easily, and this is the result for the two coefficients of the propagating wave. And then we might resort to an equation that I asked you to derive in the exercise and that we saw in the last lecture. Okay, so in the case of sub-bubble freely propagating modes, which is exactly the case of validity of this solution, then the two-point correlation function in k-space of the tensor perturbation can be connected to the coefficients of the free wave. Why? Because here I am interpreting this average now as a time average. So the oscillating part goes away or averages to one or one half, as you prefer. So now I have found from the initial conditions, let's say these two coefficients, and I can therefore calculate this guy here. by inserting the two expressions that I have here. And by doing so, you noticed, so here I will, so this average will now apply to this part of the coefficient pi r of k tau, because it is the only part which is random. Okay, so this part and the equivalent complex conjugate at momentum q. And therefore, not surprisingly, what this guy gives is this function here. So I can use this this equation, use the delta function to get rid of, use the delta function that will match with the delta function I expect from the right-hand side, and relate, therefore, the result that I'm getting here with HC, the spectral amplitude. And from HC, always in the case of a freely propagating subbubble modes, we have seen in the last lecture, one can easily infer the gravitational wave energy density power spectrum. Okay, so obviously calculated today and for modes that are well into the horizon, which are the only one of interest today. And so by doing so, what one finds in the end is this expression. Okay, so you notice here two time integrals with this a cubed that just come from this quadratic factor here. Okay. And so the AA part will give sinus sinus, the BB part will give cosinus cosinus. And therefore, in the end, I have a cosinus of eta minus, here should be tau, I apologize, this should be tau. So I have a cosinus of tau minus eta, okay? And then here comes the point, obviously I have here as a source, this an isotropic stress power spectrum, but taken at different times, okay? Because I need to take this guy squared, and therefore, in general, I have two different times here that appear. So it is really the anisotropic stress power spectrum at different times that we need to be able to model whenever we want to evaluate the signal, the gravitational wave signal from a stochastic source in the early universe. Okay, so up to now, this expression is fairly general. So what comes into this expression is that we are in the radiation era and that we are at, we calculated it for modes that are well into the horizon today. Now I can attempt a solution in a very simplified case that I'm giving just as an example. Okay, let us suppose that the duration of the source is much smaller than the Hubble time at the moment of the generation. Okay, so this star here you can identify with eta in or eta fin, it doesn't matter since we are under this condition. In this case, I can say that the integrals run over a time interval for which there is no appreciable expansion of the universe, and so I reduce these two guys to their equivalent at the source time. Furthermore, I assume that the modes, gravitational wave modes I am interested in are modes that are smaller than the Hubble factor, the Hubble parameter, let's say, at the moment of the generation. Okay, so this approximation is not I mean, it's not a very interesting one, because in general we will be concerned by modes at which the source peaks. Okay, we will see that. But for now, let's do this this assumption that allows me basically to neglect the cosinus. Remember that here there is a tau, and say that this cosinus is about one. And then I will do another crude approximation, which is to say that the time dependence of the source is just a constant, so it is a step function that turns on at eta in, is constant, and turns off at eta phi. Okay, it is a very simplified case, but it is a case for which it is trivial to find the result. And I let this as an exercise. So this is the approximated result. Gravitational wave energy density parameter, then four modes that are well into the horizon today, but well outside the horizon at the moment of the action of the source. So let's see term by term. Okay, so delta eta squared here just comes from the time integrals because there is nothing else. So this goes outside. The cosinus is one. This guy goes outside. So I just have a delta eta squared. Here I'm just simply rewriting pi of k and normalizing it, let's say. So I separate the energy moment. The energy density related to the anisotropic stress from whatever dependence in K it might have. So I'm just, if you want, I'm defining some normalized anisotropic stress power spectrum. And then I just divide by radiation squared to normalize it and then rearrange it. See, here I'm looking for the gravitational energy density parameter, so I'm divided by the critical energy density, so you can rearrange all these terms and get basically express, let's say, the gravitational wave amplitude, or no, the effect that the gravitational waves propagate like radiation from when they are free modes up to today by simply this this factor. Okay, so let us look term by term. Now, what I want to get something visible, detectable in not too far future. This guy here should be of the order, let's say, of 10 to the minus 11. This would be a guaranteed detection, for example, by ELISA, if we are in the correct frequency range, probably also by the Einstein telescope, by pulsar timing arrays with the SKA at their projected future sensitivity. So it is something that we would like to have from the early universe if we want to access this kind of signal, right? Now, all that is here is of order, say, 10 to the minus 6. Okay, this likely depends on the generation epoch through the number of relativistic degrees of freedom at the moment of the source with respect to today. And then if for this I have normalized it, so this is something that of order one, let's say, and therefore we are left with these two parts. And the first term here is the duration of the source with respect to the Hubble time. We have already seen that we assume this to be small. And here I have the ratio of, let's say, the energy density in an that goes into an isotropic stresses with respect to the background energy density of the universe at the moment of at which the source is acting. So you see that, these two quantities, the squares of these two quantities must be of order 10 to the minus 5, which is quite constraining. So it means that only slow and very anisotropic processes have the chance to generate detectable stochastic gravitational background signals. So this guy here ideally is of order 0.1, okay, which means 10% of anisotropy in the universe, so it is a lot. And this guy here as well. Mm-hmm. Okay, so this is what I want to stress by this exercise. The first point I want to stress by this exercise is that really we need processes that are quite violent, as people say, in the sense that they have a strong level of anisotropy if we want to produce a gravitational wave signal which is visible.
Chiara?
Okay, yes.
There is a question in the chat about the difference between the star and rad subscripts.
You're right, I sort of mixed the two here. So basically here I should have put rho star, which would be then the energy density at the moment at which the source is acting. And but effectively this is the radiation energy density at the moment in which the source is acting, so I called it rad. Okay, but indeed.
Thank you.
I hope it clarifies. Okay, and now let's look a little bit about the K shape of the signal, so the how the signal depends on wave number. And for this, let's go back to the two-point correlation of the anisotropic stresses. And remember the thing that I keep on repeating, the fact that they are uncorrelated on scales that are in general smaller than the horizon. In general, they have a given, let's say, correlation scale L star. In this case, the power spectrum in K will be uncorrelated for scales or separation of scales that are larger than the typical correlation scale. And if this guy here is uncorrelated, it means that it is simply flat. So in the power spectrum, we don't expect any feature. It is an uncorrelated signal. Then obviously at some point it must bend and this happens at the characteristic wave numbers, which are of the order of 1 over the characteristic size of the anisotropic stress. And then here there is, so everything which is for all scales that are smaller than the typical correlation scale, we will have a given slope that really depends on the details of the source, so on the stochastic properties of the source itself. So I'm not specifying it because this varies with respect to which physical process I assign to this type. Okay, but remember now the range of validity of this solution. So we are for wave numbers that are much smaller than 1 over eta in, so much smaller than h. Okay, and we assume then that they are also much smaller than L. Okay, and so I can say that this solution is valid in this zone here, and therefore I expect the two-point correlation function to be flat. meaning that pi here must go like k cubed. Okay, just to simplify and get it flat. So basically, the bottom line is that for modes okay, that satisfy this condition, where this second condition is inherited from this one, okay, simply. So this condition is the causality of the sourcing process, and this condition is the range of validity of the solution. In this case, the gravitational wave power spectrum, its k dependence would be directly proportional to the one of the normalized anisotropic stress power spectrum, and it is going to be a k cubed. Okay, so this is a very easy and general result that if you don't get it and your source satisfy causality and you are in the right range of k, you should be feel a bit suspicious. Okay. Now let's go on with specifying a little bit more about pi, about the anisotropic stress, and let's in particular see in the early universe what can give rise to these anisotropic stresses. I'll give a few examples. Okay, so here you have this cartoon that represents the history of the universe. So the important thing that I already stressed in the previous lectures is that gravitational waves can bring direct information from very early stages of the universe evolution, to which we have no direct access through electromagnetic radiation, and the reason is that photons are tightly coupled in the very early universe. So photon decouples here at the cosmic microwave background generation. We extend the region, say, of tested cosmology a bit further back in time because we observe the abundances of light elements, and we can predict them from Big Bang nucleosynthesis, from the hypothesis that the universe is in thermal equilibrium at around the energy scale of 1 MeV. Okay, so everything that is at energy scales that are smaller, is would refer to a tested cosmology. Okay, obviously, it's inflation as well through the CMB anisotropy. But the important thing then is that gravitational waves can give us direct access to whatever is occurring in this range of scales, to which electromagnetic observations are blind. Now, you know that at the LHC now they have discovered the Higgs, or they are pinning down the standard model of particle physics up to the energy scale of about 1 TeV. Okay, so everything that goes from, let's say, the energy scale of Big Bang nucleosynthesis to the energy scale of 1 TeV, let's say we are not so interested in the sense that it is tested physics. So we expect the standard model of particle physics to be valid. Okay, but at energy scales starting from the TeV and higher, we have no idea what is going on. So there are a lot of, there are a lot of ideas and a lot of models, but we have no we have not been able to test them apart from the theory of inflation under in some respect, though theoretically it is still pretty much unbound. Gravitational waves can give very important information in principle. Now, the converse of this is that there is no guaranteed gravitational wave signal. Okay, but because the prediction that we can make rely on untested phenomena. And sometimes they are also difficult to estimate because there are nonlinear dynamics or strongly coupled theories. So all I'm saying here now, starting from now, is in some sense speculation. Okay. Obviously, this means that we have a great potential for discovery on the other side. Now, many gravitational wave generation processes that are occurring in this early phase of the universe evolution are related to phase transitions. Okay, so what I will say now won't be exhaustive, but I will give some examples of gravitational wave generating processes that are connected with phase transitions. Okay, so what is a phase transition? A phase transition occurs when some field in a universe changes from one state to another, because this other state has become more energetically favorable due to some change in the external conditions. For example, it would be a change in temperature if we are in a phase of thermal equilibrium, in which the universe is in thermal equilibrium. Now, the first phase transition that we can deal with, starting, let's say, from the beginning, is inflation, okay, which you have already seen is the phase transition of the inflaton field, in which, so this is just one possibility of potential, right? We have no idea what this potential is. But in the mechanism of inflation, the inflaton field, scalar field, is displaced. We don't know how. So the initial conditions are such that it is displaced from its true minimum. So there is a vacuum energy which is associated to this field, and this vacuum energy gives rise to the accelerated expansion of the universe. And then, since we don't want to be stuck into a de Sitter space-time, we say that this potential, though, is a bit as a small field dependence, such that the field is driven towards the minimum of the potential. So it is really just a phase transition that occurs slowly. So it is low roll inflation. Okay, and when the field is at the bottom of the potential, there is reheating. Why? Because we need to get from a vacuum-dominated phase to a radiation-dominated phase, a thermal phase in the early universe that we measure with the CMB. So we know that the universe must have been in a thermal state at some point. And so the idea is that all the vacuum energy is then converted at the reheating process into particles, standard model, and probably beyond standard model particles into the thermal bath of particles. Okay. Now, we have already seen this, but let me just go through it quickly again to fix ideas. In the case of inflation, it is not an active source that is generating the tensor perturbation, but it is the amplification of vacuum fluctuations of the metric by the exponential expansion. So in general, what I have I haven't done anywhere in these lectures. One, but I suppose you have seen this last week, one has to quantize the metric perturbation field. But the equation remains the same, okay, for the quantum field. So that would be the amplitudes of the quantum field, and then we have that has the space-time is stretched modes exit, so wave numbers, let's say, of the field becomes smaller than the Hubble parameter. Okay, so one goes from a situation in which one has just a free field for the metric field in vacuum to a situation in which there is a very large occupation number for the field. And so one generates a spectrum of tensor metric perturbations. You have seen it already, I suppose. And the spectrum is characterized by this amplitude, okay, that depends obviously on the Hubble factor at inflation. And then it has directly inherited from the phi dependence of the potential, it has a slight dependence on the wave number. With a spectral index which is very small, and it is this related to the first derivative of the potential. Okay, so I see that I'm running extremely late. Okay, so I will speed up. I'm sorry about that. So here, basically, what you want to do is to calculate omega gravitational waves today, okay, as a function of wave number. And you do this by evaluating the transfer function of the tensor modes, okay, so which is simply, so this is the gravitational wave solution as a function of time for a given k. So you calculate it for every k, okay, and then you calculate this guy from the two point correlation function of the tensor perturbation, okay, and this is the result that you get for omega gravitational waves generated by inflation. So it has this particular shape, which is k to the minus 2 for modes that enter the Hubble horizon in the matter era, and the flux for modes that enter the horizon in the radiation era. Okay, so the transfer function is basically written here, okay, in terms of frequencies now. So 1 over f for the matter era and flux for the radiation era. So the turning point is the k at the frequency at the horizon scale at the quality between matter and radiation. And then there is this light k dependence where nt is the spectral index, is minus 2 epsilon. And the amplitude here, I write it in terms of the tensor to scalar ratio, okay, where PR now is scalar amplitude at a pivot scale, okay, at the CMB pivot scale that we measure from the CMB. This amplitude here directly depends, obviously, on R is still open. There are only upper bounds. And this gravitational wave signal from inflation is a signal which is very extended in frequencies, okay, because it is a continuous sourcing of gravitational waves as modes re-enter the Hubble horizon. So in general, it goes from the scale that entered the horizon today to the scale that never exited the horizon during inflation. So here you see it. In the case of slow roll inflation, this spectral index for this level of the inflationary potential. So it spans huge decade in frequency, two decades in frequency, no, three more. So you see, in principle, gravitational wave detector, they offer the amazing opportunity to probe the inflationary power spectrum and therefore the model of inflation down to the tiniest scales. So the scales that re-enter the horizon far into the radiation era. Contrary to the CMB, that is gives us information about inflation, but concerning the tensor spectrum probes only the very low scales, very low frequencies. Now, unfortunately, the signal, this is even the maximal signal from slow roll scenario, so vanilla inflation is certainly not detectable. Okay, the mechanism of reheating generates a signal with a high amplitude, okay, a gravitational wave signal, but unfortunately this is situated here at very high frequencies corresponding to the energy scale of inflation where we have, as for now, no detectors. Okay, so I'm not treating this case. But, if one is ready to speculate, you see, one might say, look, we know about inflation, we have observed it in the CMB, okay, at large scales. But the CMB does not provide any constraint at these very small scales here. So what if slow roll is not any longer valid over this huge range of scales, and instead we have some enhancement? And this enhancement is such that it falls into the sensitivity range of some detectors. This is a possibility. Here I just draw a line. There is nothing physical. Here I just draw this line. This means that I want to crank up this spectrum. And there are several ways in which this is possible. One can add extra fields during inflation. One can modify the inflaton potential. One can modify the gravitational interaction during inflation. One can add a phase after inflation with the stiff equation of state. So here I give just one example, okay, which pertains to the first category, adding extra fields. And you see, I just suppose that the inflaton is a pseudo-scalar and that there is some gauge field around during inflation. These are pretty minimal assumptions. Okay, and then there is this term in the Lagrangian of the inflaton and of the gauge field. There is a coupling between the inflaton and the gauge field. And since it is a gauge field, in this case, the source, so this coupling is such that the gauge field feels the expansion of the background, otherwise it would be conformally invariant, so it would not be amplified by the expansion of the background, but since it is coupled to the inflaton, it feels the expansion of the background, and so it is amplified during inflation, and so we have electromagnetic, say, the equivalent of electromagnetic fields at these high energies that operate during inflation, and they can provide a gravitational wave signal that in some situation, this is a very old analysis, but it is still valid, can amplify the spectrum, and these are proposals for the LISA sensitivity curve now, the one that has been retained is somewhere here. So in this case, this scenario would produce modulo a wise choice, obviously, of the coupling and of the inflaton potential, a signal which is visible by LISA. Okay. Now let's go on with our, let's say, revision of phase transitions in the early universe. So at scales that are comparable to the scale of inflation around there, one can have other kind of phase transition. So we don't know what is the model that is describing the theoretical model that is describing particle physics at those high energies. So we can assume that there are some extra symmetries, for example, gap symmetries, that then are broken during the evolution of the universe. Okay, so since we have no real idea about what is this symmetric theory that is describing the universe at high energy, we can speculate about the characteristics of these possible phase transitions. And if the symmetry is of given kinds, one can have the formation of topological defects. So here I am considering just the case of cosmic strings because it is the one which is most relevant for the generation of gravitational waves. Okay, so cosmic strings would arise if the symmetry breaking concerns a field, a scalar field, that has this kind of for which the true vacuum has this kind of symmetry. Okay, so it is doesn't change, the solution doesn't change with a rotation in this field direction. And in true space, this means that when the field chooses at a given point in space, one of these vacua, at the center, there must be a line of points on which the field is not is still in the false vacuum. Okay, so it is zero in this case. And this alignment of points in which the field has another value with respect to the rest of the universe is a cosmic string. Okay, so here the gravitational wave solution, here I apologize, the indexes should be on the partial derivatives. So it would be something like connected with the space gradients of this field. And in particular, one would have this is a simulation of a string network. So the universe would be filled with very long strings, okay, where there is this field value. And then these things, these strings, actually, they can chop off loops. And these loops oscillating, they produce gravitational waves. Okay, now one thing that it is important to point out about this kind of gravitational wave source is that, okay, it is fantastic because it gives you the possibility to probe the symmetries of the high energy universe. On the other hand, the signal is extremely model dependent. Okay, so what I am showing here is just one example. And here you have the omega as a function of frequency and different gravitational wave signals for different values of the string tension, which is related to the energy at which the phase transition is occurring. Okay, and here you might notice as well that the signal extends over many frequencies, since the gravitational wave production is continuous through the universe evolution. So these strings, they hang around for the entire evolution of the universe. They continuously chop off these loops that continuously produce gravitational waves. And the energy density of the network is a constant fraction of the universe one. And therefore, we have this, this flat shape at high frequencies. Okay, let me come now to another notable example of a phase transition, which is the electroweak phase transition, which is the phase transition of the Higgs field. And in this case, we can safely assume that the universe is in a thermal state. Okay, we are at the boundary of tested physics. And Within the standard model, we have predictions for this phase transition. Okay, so this phase transition could, in theory, in principle, proceed in two separate waves. It could be a second order phase transition in which there is no, so you see the variation of the potential as the temperature decreases from the high temperature phase to the low temperature phase is continuous. Or it could be first order, in which there is a second minimum developing and a potential barrier between the two vacua at a critical temperature. And then as the temperature decreases further, there is a true minimum that develops. And in this case, the field to go from the false vacuum to the vacuum that has become more energetically favorable must overcome this barrier either through quantum tunneling or through thermal fluctuation. Now, we know that in the standard model of particle physics, given the mass of the X, the phase transition is second order. Okay, and the reason why I put this cross here is because in this case there is no gravitational wave production. Okay, so if we stick to the standard model of particle physics, the electric phase transition is a second order and leads to no appreciable gravitational wave production. But if we are ready to extend the standard model beyond what has been up to now measured and tested, then we can speculate that the phase transition could be first order. And in this case, a gravitational wave production is possible. So it is possible, why? Because in this case, tunneling through the barrier corresponds to, in real space, to the generation of bubbles of the true vacuum. That must, since we know that today we are in the true minimum, these bubbles must expand very fast and collide before one Hubble time. Okay, in order, because otherwise we would be stuck somewhere. We would be see this. Okay, so now it is precisely the collision of these bubbles that produces or processes that are related to the collision of the bubbles that produce the gravitational waves. So first of all, you see that this white thing here, what it represents the region in which the field is transitioning from one vacuum to the other, and so it has a non-zero gradient. Here as well, the indexes are misplaced, I'm sorry. So when the bubble collide, they break spherical symmetry, and here we are, we can have the production of a tensor anisotropic stress. The other point is that these bubbles are actually expand into the universe plasma. Let's not forget that the universe is probably in a thermal state at that time. And therefore, and furthermore, the particles, typical particles that are around, are coupled to the X field. So the fact that we have the X field sweeping through this plasma, or this configuration of the X field sweeping through the plasma, sets the fluid into motion, producing then a bulk fluid configurations. Okay, that when the bubble are spherical, are somehow sound shells around the bubble. And when the bubble collide, lose the spherical symmetry, producing gravitational waves. Furthermore, if the the phase transition is strong enough, actually the sound waves can be converted, there could be shocks developing, and could be converted into turbulence in the fluid, in which case as well we have production of gravitational waves. At last, there are primordial magnetic fields. Why? Because this the motion is occurring in a plasma which is completely ionized, and therefore in general one has the production of currents, and one has in reality this turbulence is magnetohydrodynamic turbulence, and so one expects to have also electric and magnetic field generated by the turbulence motions. So all these three components give rise to tensor stresses that produce gravitational waves. Okay, so now I arrived at the end of my time, and not at the end of my lecture. So maybe it is better to stop, and I go on with lecture two a little bit tomorrow. I don't know what you suggest.
Sorry, you said you would. I didn't understand what was the proposal.
The proposal is that, so I'm asking you if you prefer that I continue, or if you prefer that I stop here and I go on with this lecture tomorrow.
But I guess I see a couple of questions in the chat about you already talked, so maybe we can discuss these questions and then continue tomorrow with the new extra material.
Okay.
Okay, so should I read them? I think one of them was about astrophysical processes, whether those can be considered as a source of the stochastic gravitational waves.
So astrophysical processes, we will see them in the next lecture, the generation of gravitational waves from binaries. They can also source gravitational waves, and in that they can also source a stochastic background, okay? And in that case, the stochastic background comes from the superposition of many signals from individual binaries that have a signal-to-noise ratio in your detector which is too low, and so they cannot be individually resolved as merger events or as in spiraling binaries, and therefore but they are still emitting gravitational waves, and therefore all these gravitational waves, they somehow add up in the detector as a stochastic background. So it is a stochastic background because there is nothing fundamental. The reason why it is a stochastic background, because your detector is not perfect.
Thanks. So the another question was about the size of cosmic strings, the typical size of the cosmic strings.
If what you mean is the length, it is basically the entire universe. Okay, they evolve over, or they stretch over the Hubble size. And then this particular condition here, which is called the Nambu-Goto model, consists in assuming that their size here is tiny with respect to their length, which is a very good assumption.
But I guess there is another question or discussion going in the chat about the plasma before the Higgs phase transition. But I guess the question is what are the particles that form this plasma before the Higgs phase transition?
Well, according to the standard models, there are the quarks, right? There are the W bosons, the Z bosons that are massless. There are electrons, neutrinos, positrons, photons, maybe gravitons, if they are there for some process, and that's it.
So everything except that they are massless particles.
Yeah. Exactly, and there is maybe also dark matter, some dark matter particles there should be in principle if dark matter is real.
Okay, yeah, I don't see any other question in the chat, but I don't know, maybe if there is one other question, we can take it and then finish the. Finish this session. Well, perhaps there is no other question for now. Thank you. Chiara.
Okay, so I apologize that I miscalculated the length of this lecture. I actually was going very slow in the beginning, we will finish tomorrow, and then tomorrow we will go to binaries as well, partition with some binaries. Okay.
Okay. Thanks.
Thank you very much. Bye bye.